afternoon, everybody. I'm really privileged to be here. This may be third or fourth time when I have an occasion to come to NIA for the C.V. Deshmukh lecture series. And today, of course, I'm more happy because as a moderator, I have got a panel which is actually they are all eminent in their own fields, and I will call it as a heavy panel. You know, we have about 1 hour 10 minutes here, so initially I will set the tone of the subject for about 10-15 minutes, and then give 10-12 minutes for each of the speakers to put their views on the subject. And then for 10 minutes, we will have question answers if at all you have. So thereby, we will have good time management. Friends, the subject here is life insurance, social security, and financial inclusion. Many times we feel that social security is only for the poor. It's not necessarily for the poor. Actually, it's for everybody. Because we do not know when somebody will become poor. Just to give you an example, the morbidity risk is so high nowadays, and the expense of health care, I will say, is so high that any major illness can bring about a financial change in the status of a person from above poverty line to below poverty line. I remember when the first open heart surgery was performed by the surgeon, I am not remembering his name, but after that, what he said, I do remember. He had said that I saved the patient, but I made him poor. The expenses of surgery were so huge that the person who was operated upon had nothing left for survival. So it's not that the social security is only for the rich or only for the poor. It's equally for everybody who is an individual, who is earning or not earning, male or female, child or old person, of any age for that matter. Now the issue is, obviously, the social security for the poor is of paramount importance because they do not have their avenues even to make both ends meet. They cannot have full two square meal a day, and hence if something happens, then there is nothing to rely upon or fall back on. So it is absolutely important and essential for the poor to be covered into social security. I remember a few years back, there was a lot of controversy, debate on a statement by the then president of US, who said that the shortage of food grains is mainly because of people in the developing countries or underdeveloped countries. Some such statement he had made. Actually, that does not mean that the underdeveloped countries eat more food grains. It's not so. But probably what he meant was that these underdeveloped countries are moving from the lower level of income to slightly higher level of income, per capita income. As a result of which, in India, 40% of the poor people were not able to have the second meal in a day. Now with higher level of income, they may have the second meal, and thereby the food grains will be consumed more in the developing economies. But it was taken different spirit, and a lot of criticism was there on that statement. But friends, the fact remains that all sorts of social benefits, I will say, are required to be provided to the people below poverty line. You may be aware that the definition of below poverty line varies from state to state. And every state determines under certain criteria and conditions how the family can be termed as BPL. It's not only income. Income is one of the criteria. But more than that, what is the level of literacy? Where do they stay, in the sense, what is the quality of house that they have where they are staying? What is the status of children? How many children do they have? What sort of clothing do they have or they don't have? Moreover, they don't have. And what is their land holding? What are the sanitation facilities that are available to them? Taking all these factors into account, every state determines and decides what are the BPL families. And once it is decided, then they are entitled for some aid from the government in the form of, say, some group insurance schemes for the poor, which are by LIC, like Aam Aadmi Bima Yojana or Janashri Bima Yojana, which were in vogue at some point of time, or maybe Landless Agricultural Labour Group Insurance Scheme, which was there, or the food supplies which are available to them, or the free education which is available to the children, so on and so forth. So the issue is, ultimately what is important is, we want to lift them from below poverty line to above poverty line. But many times it so happens that although their level of income may go up and they may move from below poverty line to slightly above the poverty line, a one calamity in their life again brings them down to the below poverty line level. There is no sustainability at that level. And that is precisely what happens in case of untimely death of the breadwinner. And that is where the insurance plays a prominent role. The PMJJBY, which was announced year before, got a good response. In the first year itself, more than 2 crore families were covered under PMJJBY, and almost 9 or 10 crore under PM Suraksha Bima Yojana, that is, which was covering only accidental death. And the cover was 2 lakh rupees, and the amount of premium was debited to their bank account and directly going to the insurance companies. You'll be surprised to know that in the past, in no year, all the insurance companies together, of course LIC had a major share, they had never sold 2 crore term insurance policies to individuals. Never sold. But it happened in case of PMJJBY. For the reason, one, the methodology of payment of premium was at ease. You don't have to keep collecting premium individually going door to door. It was directly debited to the bank account and collected. Second was, a lot of awareness was created. Publicity was there. I think, including LIC and IRDA, we spent almost 200 crores by way of publicity of the scheme. And initially there was an apprehension in the minds of insurance companies, insurers, that the scheme may not be economically viable. And it was not economically viable in the first year. You can never expect generating profit right from day one, especially in case of social security schemes. But over a period of time, if you are in a position to see that the scheme becomes slightly profitable. You should not have profit as an aim for such schemes. But again, that does not mean that you should incur losses year after year. If that happens, then I think the purpose is served. And in the second year, it was observed that the scheme could make just break even with some of the insurers. And I'm sure from third year onwards, the scheme will not be loss-making in respect of most of always said that the bad lives which are insured in the first year, they become good lives in the second year. There was an apprehension that people who are on the deathbed would be insured. So all those who were on deathbed probably would have died. Those who are surviving are good lives. So the second year experience will definitely be better. Secondly, it was thought that in order to rule out this possibility, there should be some sort of control which should be exercised. So there was a declaration of good health which was required, or 45 days of leave was introduced at that point of time in the second year. See, actually, such type of insurance, although it may be individual insurance, it is actually a group insurance only. Although we cannot call it as a group insurance from that perspective, because there is, in case of group insurance, there should be a nodal agency, and the claims are settled with the nodal agency, not with the individual, so on and so forth. There is a distinction between the two. But as far as working or costing of the scheme is concerned, such schemes do work on group insurance, although they are individuals. And I'm sure that such schemes will definitely be economically viable over a period of time. So friends, LIC also has been doing a good job in promoting social security rather. They are in talks with the government for coming out with a synchronized all group schemes under social security umbrella to be merged together. That discussion is going on. This is not the forum for discussing what government is thinking of. But in order to avoid the multiplicity of lives, because there are multiple schemes, and one person who is below poverty line may be covered under 2-3 schemes, which is actually not expected of. So government thought that we should have merger of these schemes and have come out with one social security scheme by way of which maybe 3-4 crores of population can be covered. So friends, this is precisely what is required. And moreover, as I said, in case of death of the breadwinner, the entire family again comes back below the poverty line. That should be avoided, for which it is essential that the accident cover or maybe life cover should be extended to such families. And how do we include financial inclusion is also one of the topics which we are going to have deliberation on here. We find that most of these families, since their savings levels are pretty low, they do not come into the traditional forms of financial inclusions. They may be keeping their money in cash at home, or maybe in gold or some non-financial savings. So it is also essential that at some point of time, when they come up beyond the above the poverty line, they have some sort of earning which they can save. Their savings should get converted into financial savings, and we should bring them into financial inclusion. The work done by NBFCs and self-help groups is really commendable in this regard. And they have been ensuring that a large section of population from India is brought into the financial inclusion. Banks also are playing a big role through expansion of their branches throughout India, and opening large number of bank accounts of all these persons. So friends, what is important is how do we do it? These are all good principles which are there in academics, written in books, that we need to do it. The question comes, how do we do it? And that is essentially what I expect that the panelists here will be in a position to throw light on. And we should be in a position to get some new ideas from them as to how these social security and financial inclusion can happen in India. So with these introductory remarks, I would now invite Mayur, who is not only a fellow of Institute of Chartered Accountants, he is also a chartered accountant and also a law graduate. This is probably, I have not come across many examples, rather he is the only example before me who has got a degree on chartered accountants. See, chartered accountants look after assets and the actuaries look after liabilities. So here is a person who looks after both. So I welcome Mayur for the next as a next panelist.